Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to this, the 10th meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. I'd like to remind virtual members to place an R in the chat function on BlueJeans if they would like to come in on any of the issues. Agenda item one is a decision to take some business in private. Do the committee agree to take agenda item three, which is the consideration of the evidence that we're going to hear today, in private? Are we in agreement? I'm very grateful for that. Now move to agenda item two, which is based on the inquiry that we're doing onto future parliamentary procedure and practice. And for this evidence session, we are joined by Dr. Ruth Fox, who is a director of the Hansard Society. With the Society, Ruth is responsible for the strategic direction and performance of the Society and leads on its research programmes. And in this first panel, we're also joined by Professor Meg Russell from University College London. Meg Russell is Professor of British and Comparative Politics and also a Director of the Constitution Unit. Hopefully, I will be able to say remotely, welcome to the committee. Oh, I can see Dr. Ruth Fox. Good morning, Dr. Fox. Waiting to see we can hear you now, Dr. Fox. Thank you. I'm just waiting to see whether Professor Russell can join us. And I can now see Professor. Oh, good morning, Professor Russell. Yeah.
Hello.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning. I hope you heard the introduction. And what I would like to do, really, because as always with these evidence sessions, time is always quite tight. So the committee have a number of questions, but I hope that from these questions we can develop a discussion which will aid us in the evidence that we're collecting for our inquiry. So I'm going to kick off as privilege of convener, which is grab the good questions. And my first one really is about the flexibility and the participation of members where we've had virtual participation. And I wonder whether, or I'm looking for your comments on whether or not that you feel that MSPs, whether it should be routinely acceptable or allowed for them to join in a hybrid format, and what the sort of cautions are that sit around that. I don't know which of the panellists would like to start. If I come to you, Professor Russell, would you have a comment on that?
Oh. Sorry, I'm getting delayed by the fact that we were told that our microphones would be controlled by somebody else. So I'm waiting to be switched on, but
you are, yes. The microphones will be controlled by other people, but you are switched on and we can hear you very clearly.
You can hear. Okay, great. I'd just like to preface my remarks. This is not an opening statement or anything, but I would just like to preface my remarks by saying I'm not a close follower of events and developments in the Scottish Parliament. So I honestly don't know how far you've got with experimentation with hybrid and virtual proceedings and what your current thinking is. And I'm also not, in general, very familiar with your procedures. So excuse me if I talk in a rather sort of general sense, but I've been watching this at Westminster, and I have a little bit of familiarity with what's been happening in other places around the world. And my basic answer to your question is that I think that parliaments are places that need to include people who are actually present. And so I would be very cautious in how far you adopt long-term virtual arrangements. I mean, my own work has shown, and I think anybody who's worked in a legislature knows, that while they're very public places and very formal places with lots of rules and procedures, a great deal of what matters in legislatures is what goes on informally and behind the scenes. And if people are not present, then they're actually not able to participate in all of those kinds of informal communications, negotiations, and so on. And so while, and I think Ruth is broadly on the same page as me on this, while there can be good reasons to facilitate virtual participation, obviously in the case of a large scale problem like the pandemic, where that needs to apply to everybody, or perhaps in short term specific individual cases, you know, where people are, you know, in, I don't know, we might talk about this later, but, you know, in the later stage of stages of pregnancy, or have an extremely young child, or some sort of temporary arrangement, I think it's worthy of consideration. But as a long term arrangement, as a sort of blanket arrangement that might apply to everybody, I would be very cautious about going down that road, because I think that it would basically cause a parliament to malfunction in very important ways and break down essential communication mechanisms that parliaments and policymaking rely on.
That's very interesting, Professor Russell. So not in the formulaic way that legislation is created or the way that committees sit. The problem doesn't lie with that, but it lies with those softer, almost very challenging to measure interactions that happen face to face and in person, that actually facilitate the greater ideal of producing legislation and getting work done.
Yes, you put it very well. I mean, I think there are some problems which we might talk about with respect to the formal proceedings as well. You know, there are technical problems about how do you get spontaneity in debates. How do you indicate to the chair, all of these kinds of things which we've been grappling with in legislatures as well as in, you know, other events and meetings in other parts of our lives as well. But I think the fundamental problem, which cannot ultimately be solved by technological fixes, is that, you know, I mean, you mentioned legislation. I've written a book on the legislative process at Westminster based on very close study of both amendments and talking to people through interviews, and you can learn a lot from the formal record in terms of what people say in debate and the wording of amendments and the votes and what gets passed and what doesn't get passed. But having collected data on nearly 4,500 amendments on 12 bills in the Westminster Parliament going through both chambers, the interviews that we did with people about the process were much more enlightening in terms of the true dynamics of what was going on. And that's because we were talking to people about the behind the scenes meetings that backbenchers had had with ministers, that backbenchers had had with each other across party, the alliances that get built in support of amendments, and the sort of gentle behind the scenes, subtle pressure which is put on. I mean, you know, I'm quite fascinated by what's going on at Westminster today. Obviously, we've got this vote on whether the Prime Minister should be referred to the Privileges Committee, and we've seen a government amendment go down last night, which is trying to see off a rebellion. And those things are not happening because of what's happening on the formal record. Those things are happening because of people going along in groups or individually to each other's offices to put pressure on the minister, or, you know, all of that cannot happen virtually. You can try and approximate to it with phone calls and WhatsApp messages and maybe one-to-one sort of video calls. But the sense of what the dynamic is in a legislature, even in the chamber itself, actually, I would suggest, the sense of, certainly at Westminster, the mood in the chamber being very important. You know, the sort of subtle noises that are coming from members, the looks that people are giving each other, the gestures, all of that is missing. Virtually. And without that, if you reduce a parliament just to its formal on the record proceedings in a fairly kind of rigid and unspontaneous way, a great deal of politics, perhaps most of politics, is gone from that dynamic, I would suggest.
So there is a risk with hybrid that the relationship politics, the I'm going to use this word carefully and then regret it immediately. The reality of how parliaments work that perhaps are not transparent to constituents outside of the place are actually so important, and that certainly at this stage, technology is unable to provide anything near that equivalent. Would that be fair?
I would say that, yes. I mean, when I when I talk to my students, and I teach, I've taught for years courses on not just the British Parliament, but parliaments comparatively. And one of the first things that I say to them is that there are some fundamental principles of how parliaments work. One of them is equality, actually, which we might come to, because there is a problem about if some people have the face-to-face access and others don't, you create inequalities. And, you know, you then get some people being listened to more than others and so on. But one of the most fundamental principle, I think, of parliaments in many ways is openness. It's one of the things which distinguishes them from other aspects of government and sort of other public institutions, that there's so much going on the public record. It's transcribed, it's televised, etc. But there's a paradox, because while they are fundamentally open institutions, they're kind of like icebergs. Actually, so much of what matters is going on beneath the surface. So you have to understand both of those things to understand parliaments properly. The importance of their openness and things being on the record and ministers explaining themselves in a public place and all different parties making declarations of their positions and so on publicly on the record. But if you only look at that, you're not understanding the place. It's all the stuff that goes on beneath the surface that gets to those positions that makes politics work, I would say.
Thank you, Professor Russell. Just before I bring you in, Dr. Fox, I think Edward has a question that he would like to raise. Edward.
Yes, I'm finding that really interesting. And I'm sat here only able to see Professor Meg talking about this. I can't see the reaction of any other committee member, because she, when she's talking, is the only person on the screen. It is no way that I can see what you're all feeling, whether you're agreeing or whether you're not agreeing. And is that the fundamental point that you're making, Meg, that as a politician, you cannot interpret other people's opinions and the way they're swinging when people are talking?
Well, I think that's part of it, yes. I think reading the room, I mean, you know, we're all going through this, whether we're parliamentarians or not. We're all having virtual meetings and feeling that frustration. You know, I've chaired a lot of meetings, and it's quite hard with apologies to the chair, it's quite hard to shut people up if they're talking for too long. All of those little dynamics where, you know, you raise an eyebrow, you raise a pen, all of those interactions are really important. So the reading of the room is really important. But I'm making a different point as well, a separate point, which is that what goes on outside the room is often at least as important, if not more important, as what's going on in the room.
Thank you, Professor. Dr. Fox, would you like to comment on this?
Yes, good morning. I largely agree with everything that Meg has said. And I think the core of the discussion from the perspective of a parliament is, do you want to have permissive or restrictive criteria for virtual participation? Do you want virtual participation to be a short-term solution to a particular logistical or operational problem? Members who can't travel to the parliament, for example, because of weather or travel breakdowns, transport problems? Or do you want it to be a longer term option that some or all or a significant number of members might take up because they, you know, it's a way of engaging, involving members who might otherwise not be able to be parliamentarians. So people who've got caring responsibilities, for example, and those are long term propositions, and therefore they're not going to be present in the parliament a lot. They're going to be predominantly working from home and engaging virtually. Now, to some extent, you have to then ask the question from a point of principle, what is the problem that you think you have, and what is it therefore that you are trying to solve? If parity of participation of underrepresented groups is a significant problem, then virtual participation might offer you a solution. But there's a very, very significant trade-off on all the things that Meg has talked about. You know, the culture of the institution would change considerably. It wouldn't necessarily change considerably if it was a short-term stopgap measure for a few members from time to time in order to enable, you know, members, you know, not to be able to participate or to vote, for example, if they got COVID and had to isolate for a week. Or they had a particular short-term illness, which meant that they couldn't travel to the Parliament. So, you know, it avoids them being disenfranchised from proceedings and also from voting if you provide a virtual or a proxy voting option. And the cultural loss for the institution will be smaller. I think what I would also just add is that if you think about it's true of Scotland, it's true of the other devolved legislatures, it's true of Westminster, that some of the problems possibly have been exacerbated in terms of communication and have appeared sharper because the pandemic either happened shortly after an election or continued through an election, and therefore what you've had where you had turnover of members, you've actually got quite a significant number of new members who've not got experience of anything other than pandemic procedures for quite a considerable period of time. And that inevitably affects socialisation. And we don't know yet whether, you know, the kinds of things that Meg is talking about, the sort of the building of political alliances, the sort of relationships between members across parties, the functioning of committees in person, whether that will immediately revert to a sort of pre-pandemic model or actually it will prove to be slightly different because members' experience in their early months and years has been so different to what their predecessors would have experienced.
To pursue that slightly, Dr. Fox, do you think, and being a member who came in during COVID to this Parliament here, so never saw it in its as somebody described it, its golden time, although I think its golden time is still to come. Do you think that that human beings don't have the ability to overstep that communication problem, which was meeting and talking in person straight away? Do you not think that we are capable of creating a different culture that would still facilitate the creation of laws through the outside of chamber discussions, however that does happen? Do you not think, or do you have, should we have a confidence that the human being in themselves, their ability to communicate and articulate, will find ways even when the ability to sit in the same room doesn't exist?
I think we could, and that may well be with technology where we're headed, if perhaps certain companies have their way. But I agree with you that the sort of the idealisation of plenary proceedings, for example, that was something that certainly came out at Westminster during the sort of early months of the hybrid virtual proceedings, and was a reason why the then leader of the House used the argument about the sort of this idealisation of debate and participation to turn off the virtual proceedings for a considerable period of time. I think some of the problems of, you know, that you see virtually are also replicated in debate, just in a different form. And it may well be that as technology develops and moves on, and as we all become more accustomed to that, then forms of communication and the way we engage will naturally change. I think there is a risk actually for parliaments that if all the parliaments around the world sort of take a view to restrict or turn off virtual proceedings, it could actually hinder technological development. And we won't see the possibility of improvements that we might have done had things continued. So, I mean, I know at Westminster, for example, that they thought that it was going to be possible to come up with a model to allow greater interventions and supplementaries during debate to improve legislative scrutiny proceedings, for example. But no, there was no commitment to invest and to test and to trial that. And I think until parliaments commit to doing that, we won't see those kind of developments. I think it's slightly harder in terms of what Meg was talking about in terms of the informal space and the informal communications, and inevitably harder at the start of a new parliament with lots of new members who simply don't know each other. But I suppose the question is, to what extent should the institution or parties seek to orchestrate forums or environments online in which that kind of communication can take place, but which are not necessarily formal proceedings? And to what extent do you just simply leave it to members and say, you know, if you've got a particular legislative matter you want to pursue, an amendment, or you've got a policy concern at committee level, you know, leave it to members to pick up the phone and talk to each other and engage that way. But inevitably, those social cues that you garner from in-person engagement are lost.
It's interesting you should raise the question of interventions, because here within the Scottish Parliament, much work has been done to allow the hybrid system to start to take interventions. And hopefully we'll be able to investigate those between now, Edward's shaking his head, investigate those between now and summer recess. But if I can pick up that point from you, Dr. Fox, and also press Professor Russell on this, is there a responsibility, or where do you think the responsibility should be to help develop this communication? Should it rest with the political parties? So if we take a simple example of who should be able to, use a hybrid facility, should that rest with the chamber, in our case, the presiding officer, the speaker? Should it rest and be facilitated by the political parties? And is there anybody who's disadvantaged by hybrid proceedings, or indeed advantaged by the opportunity for a hybrid contribution? Professor Russell?
I would be quite firmly, instinctively at least, until I've had more time to think about this, I would be quite firmly opposed to this lying in the hands of the parties. And I think that one of the things that we've seen in legislatures around the world under the pandemic with reduced participation is that it really matters who gets to participate and who doesn't get to participate. And actually it can suit the political parties for their members to be absent. It can make the whips' lives easier if awkward people are not around. And particularly, I don't know if you're going to come on to the topic of proxy voting, but I think that what happened at Westminster was quite appalling, to be honest, in terms of hundreds of proxy votes lying in the hands of party whips, which, you know, I was horrified by that. It was something that I had seen something similar in the New Zealand Parliament, but I never thought that we were going to get there at Westminster. And I also think it was totally unnecessary, because there was an electronic voting system which had been rapidly set up and seemed to be very efficient, and yet the government prevented its continuation. But I think that it goes back partly to this point about equality, I think, that I raise, that equality, you know, equality is fundamental to democracy, and parliaments as democratic institutions have equality as a core principle, that everybody should have sort of equal rights to participate. And if some people are encouraged to stay away, then I think those people are not fully included in some of the most important aspects of politics. And there are very severe risks, I think. I think there is Ruth put it very nicely in terms of the long term and the short term, and also the fundamental trade-offs that we face here. And I know that you've got Sarah Childs, I believe you've got Sarah Childs on your next panel, who's a real champion of improved participation, particularly for women in legislatures. And she's hugely respected. And, you know, I would count her as a friend as well as an excellent colleague. But I think that the pressure to increase virtual opportunities in order to improve participation for certain groups who may currently be excluded from legislatures, women, carers, people with disabilities, and so on. There is this very awkward trade-off with being fully part of the decision-making process. And I think that there is this sense that virtual participation is essentially a sort of second best kind of participation. So as Ruth has said, in certain circumstances, if somebody's isolating with COVID or whatever, second best is better than nothing at all. But if you've got some people who are locked out long term, then you've got those people are second class members, in a sense. They've got a second best kind of participation. And if that means that you are excluding groups who have traditionally been excluded from legislatures, and it looks on the face of it as if they are included, but actually their participation is not equal to that of others, you're in a way perpetuating the problem. And I think if you, I'm straying away from your question a bit, but in terms of who makes the decisions, I would say that these need to be institution-wide decisions. I don't know enough about the Scottish Parliament to know quite where the right place is, but when you say presiding officer, that feels about right to me. I think these things need very careful thinking through, cross-party basis, close involvement of officials and experts and the presiding officer. But there is this, even then, there is a risk of you can come up with things which suit all the parties, but actually don't necessarily suit democracy as a whole. And I think we saw a bit of that at Westminster with the proxy voting. Mm-hmm. The Conservative whip had hundreds of votes in their pocket. The Labour whip had hundreds of votes in their pocket. The Conservative and Labour members didn't mind, frankly, letting the whips vote for them. But democracy suffers in that situation nonetheless. So I think you've got to be very, very careful of party interests colliding with the interests of broader democracy and of advantaging whips and party leaders, perhaps against some of their more awkward backbench members who might gently be eased out of some forms of participation.
Thank you, Professor. I think Colette Stevenson has a sort of slight follow-up question on that. Colette?
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Professor Russell. You touched upon equality being the key, one of the key principles in terms of politics. I just wanted to touch upon the actual makeup and logistics of Westminster. So there's 650 MSPs, there's 427 seats. So in terms of equality, it doesn't seem to be very equitable in that respect. I just wonder if you want to comment on that.
Well, I would be the first to accept that equality isn't perfect, and I mean that we're not there. That is what I mean by isn't perfect. And in many respects, I'm completely on the same side as Sarah Childs in terms of wanting to see a broader range of people standing for Parliament, facilitated to be members of Parliament and participating in Parliament. But what I mean is that participation, the quality of that, to really respect the principle of equality, that participation needs to be equal. We actually had a case during the pandemic when some people in the House of Commons were able to vote in person and other people who were required to stay away for health reasons could not vote. That was another appalling incident, I think, during the pandemic in the UK Parliament. So you've got to be very careful that you don't set up a situation where on paper it looks like you've got a nice broad spread of participation, but actually the people who are really at the heart of things taking the decisions are not a representative group. Maybe they are more male. Maybe they are the non-parents. Maybe they are people who are of a particular age or a particular, you know, wealth band or whatever. That would be a retrograde step. You need full participation of everybody on an equal basis. And the risk with the virtual participation is that you slip into some people who are not present, not really being there when the decisions are being taken. Because if the real decisions are taken behind the scenes, and they're just logging in for the formal meetings, their voices are not fully being heard.
Thank you, Professor. I'm going to pass over to Bob, who I think will have a question and then take the conversation forward.
Yes, it's been a really interesting discussion. Thank you to both of our witnesses. I was kind of, one of the things about virtual meetings, of which this is a kind of hybrid version, is when I kind of make my facial expression or twist uncomfortably my chair, you can't read my body language. And I got a lot of the commentary was through a Westminster lens and a Westminster culture, and I think things are very different in the Scottish Parliament. First of all, there are 129 members of the Scottish Parliament. I think across party it's been understood that it's much easier to get access to ministers and to feed things in very, very quickly. For example, we're in a hybrid meeting, but I could see Edward shaking his head, so there's a positive strength for the hybrid meeting that I could read Edward's body language there. So I suppose this follow-up question I wanted before I move things on a little bit was in relation to equality, was mentioned, I think, by Professor Russell quite a lot, but of course, equality, there's various strands to that. There's a equality of opportunity rather as well as equality of access. And if some women can never get into the parliament because they're deterred because they don't see it as family friendly, then they don't have the opportunity in the first place to be elected representatives on the same basis as men. Equality of opportunity for carers, equality of opportunity for, I've got a young child in the house, for dads to still have contact with their young children from time to time. And I think this parliament is talking about a hybrid parliament rather than a virtual parliament. And I think there's a kind of cross-party will not to put this hybrid parliament back in its box, but to get the balance right between inclusion in the parliamentary campus and that dynamic that I think Professor Russell explained very, very well, and Dr. Fox, but also make sure we're not denying the opportunity to underrepresented groups and the opportunity to support members. So can I ask Dr. Fox and Professor Russell to maybe briefly comment on whether they think that for opportunities for people to be elected representatives in the first place or to sustain their incumbency as an elected representative, i.e. would some women give up being MSPs in the last term because they didn't see it family friendly enough, that hybrid is important, that we endure the strengths of hybrid rather than throw it out. So maybe Professor Russell, in the first instance.
Sure. I think it depends what you mean by hybrid, really, doesn't it? Maybe we need to sort of look into that term a bit more closely. So what you mean by hybrid is that everybody is participating some of the time in person and sometimes virtually, then I think that's a much more defensible position than a hybridity where some people are always there and some people are always online. Because I would say that the people who are online are not being heard to the extent to which the people in the room are being heard. And that would be a bit of a false kind of picture of participation that you were creating. So there's different ways of being hybrid.
Professor Russell, I don't think I was creating any form of false concept of participation. This is a hybrid meeting we have just now. We are having that interaction at the moment. So I suppose the question I was actually asking, took me a long time to get there, Professor Russell, but the question I was actually asking is about whether the advantages of hybrid parliament for opportunity for underrepresented groups far outweighs some of the limitations that you mentioned, which I would note seems to be through a Westminster lens and culture.
Well, and what I'm saying is it depends on your definition of hybrid. So, look, I mean, to give a clear example, I think it's absolutely fantastic that myself and Ruth are able to be here with you today. And it's a great deal easier to do that the way that we're doing it now than through us both travelling up to Edinburgh and being there in person. And maybe the trade-offs of being able to see your body language and whether you're all glaring at each other because you think I'm talking rubbish, maybe that's a trade-off worth making in this case. But what I'm saying is hybrid could mean one of several things. One of them is that everybody, you know, one day a week or one week a month or something works from home and dials in via video link. That would be a very, very different arrangement to one where, say, half of the members are always present and the other half are never there. And the second of those models would become particularly problematic if the half who were there were, say, the men, and the ones who were staying at home with the caring responsibilities were the women. So I think you have to go beyond the word hybrid and ask what the rules are for this hybridity, how exactly it's going to work. That's all I'm saying.
I think that's very helpful, Professor. Dr. Fox, what are your comments on this?
Yeah, I draw a distinction between recruitment of candidates to be members and retention of members once they're in the parliament. So there are lots of reasons why women, people from disabled groups, people with caring responsibilities sort of the underrepresented groups in our parliaments don't necessarily stand for public office. And I suspect that there are other factors, toxicity of public life, you know, social media, sort of the threats to people in politics weigh heavily as much as the sort of the how do I manage my caring responsibilities and work-life balance. There's a complex mix of factors. And for potential candidates, if you're talking about recruitment into the parliament, there's a stage before getting there, being a candidate. And yes, if the parliament is more, if you put it this way, family-friendly, if it facilitates a better work-life balance and an ability to manage things like caring responsibilities, then that's clearly attractive. But if party political activity doesn't facilitate that at the recruitment level, then I'm not sure it's necessarily the solution you're hoping for, to the extent that you're perhaps hoping for it. Having said that, I think if you're talking about retention of members, and I know, you know, the four female MPs who said prior to the last election that explicitly they were standing down because of this work-life balance issue and caring responsibilities for relatives and sick relatives and children. Virtual proceedings or hybrid proceedings that enabled them to balance out those responsibilities, even if only on a short-term basis, from time to time, rather than having to, you know, having it on a permanent long-term basis, and for the reasons Meg's alluded to, may well be helpful. So if you think retention of members is a problem, then it could provide a possible solution. But as Meg has said, there are important trade-offs that go with that.
Thank you, Dr. Fox. Bob?
Just thank you to both of you. I'm really pleased I pushed on that because I think we get some really valuable evidence from Professor Russell and Dr. Fox there. So thank you for your responses to that. A more general question now. I mean, clearly some form of hybrid parliament will remain, and this committee's task is trying to touch, feel, smell what that would look like and make recommendations to presiding officer in parliament in relation to that. I'm guessing that would be an iterative process. So whatever this committee comes up with and parliament agrees to would not be the end point. Professor Ross has been very helpful about how monitoring some of the dynamics at Westminster, and one of the things we'll want to do in the Scottish Parliament is whatever reforms we recommend and we implement initially, is we want to monitor some of that. So my question would be is, how can we monitor hybrid and virtual proceedings going forward to measure how interactions have changed and whether that's been beneficial, what the benefits have been, what the drawbacks have been, because whatever we recommend, we're going to want to monitor that on an ongoing basis. That will not be the end of the story. So any suggestions you could have on how we monitor the quality of those interactions and the negatives as well as the positives would be very helpful. Maybe Dr. Fox?
Having inquiries like this is useful. I mean, this is something that Westminster really hasn't done properly. It hasn't reflected on, you know, what aspects of virtual, fully virtual and hybrid proceedings members liked and what they didn't, and then come up with sort of proposition about how proceedings might be improved. So I think having an inquiry through a committee that can monitor this on an ongoing basis is extremely valuable. There are obvious things you can do in terms of surveys of members. Participation levels are always an issue. I think you have to think about what are the data points that you want to monitor. You know, is it the participation levels in terms of speaking time? Is it interventions? You know, are there issues for members in terms of if they're operating virtually for a period of time, do they have equal access and opportunity to participate in certain types of proceedings? Interrogatory aspects of proceedings, question time, for example, as opposed to legislative scrutiny, then, you know, you can more easily monitor that. But it really depends upon how the business is managed and therefore what aspects of the business you look at in detail. And obviously a lot of the parliamentary data that I'm sure the officials, the clerks and the librarians are producing would enable that to happen.
Dr. Fox, I'm not sure if you were finished or your connection was intermittent.
We lost you for a short moment there, Dr. Fox, in the middle of it. But I think what you're saying is that collecting and analysing the data is very important, but what we should do is choose what data points we want to reflect the information that we need. Would that be fair?
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm just slightly conscious of time, but would it be all right if I passed over to Edward, because I think some of the other question was pretty much covered. Edward, can I pass over to you, please?
Yeah, and Camino, I'm going to limit my questions, but can I just refreshing it is to hear from our two witnesses and just put on the record that for the last year, through no choice of my own, but for medical reasons, I have had to be virtual or hybrid for nearly every session of the committee and for every session of the Parliament. I long to get back, and I think it's refreshing to hear how important it is to make the connections with people. So in my week back in the Parliament, I was able to have off-the-record conversations and coffees with cabinet secretaries to discuss things that were difficult to do online, virtually impossible, and those relationships have been built up over the previous session. I got to know them, and that is so, so important. So I think that's a point both witnesses have brought out. And I just want to ask two very quick questions. One is, do both the witnesses think that there should be different arrangements for ministers who are giving evidence, not only to the Parliament, but also to committees? Do they need to be present so we can see what they're saying and see how they're reacting? Or do you think they should just be allowed to do it online where they have a habit of talking the time out? So happy to go to Meg first and then Ruth. That's all right.
Yes, thank you. And then very interesting to hear about your own experience there. And I think Ruth referred to this, that there is a difference between people who have been in the Parliament for a long time and then have to do a period of virtual participation because you've already got the established relationships, and people who maybe arrive virtually. And I think there would be a bit of a danger in opening up the possibility that you can stand because you don't ever actually have to go. I feel that myself in my working life, that the lockdown was much easier amongst colleagues who had known each other and been working with each other for a long time. You can pick up the signals even through online communication, whereas the new members of staff who joined, it's much harder to read them. And so I think that the sort of long-term, short-term thing is very important. And in terms of your talking to cabinet secretaries and all of that, I should throw into this meeting what I thought was a wonderful line from Philip Norton, who's a member of the House of Lords, but also one of our foremost scholars on both Westminster and Parliaments comparatively. He talks very much about the importance of informal politics. And he said, it is impossible to bump into a minister on WhatsApp. So those kind of spontaneous meetings that you have in corridors where you end up having conversations that you weren't even planning to have, but which actually can change the course of events sometimes, are completely missing in the virtual environment. So I guess that takes us to ministers. That's a really difficult one, I think. I think it's really hard to set the rules. It was mentioned that the rules have to be set and then kept under review, and there are always risks in there of precedents being set, conventions getting stretched, and so on over time. It wouldn't surprise you that I would generally say that it's far, far better for ministers to be there, because they ought to be able to read the room, you ought to be able to read them, there ought to be the potential to bump into them afterwards and all of the things which usually happen. Ministers, of course, have very busy lives. Sometimes, they might be in India or somewhere like today, maybe there are some times when particularly people with briefs that are likely to take them far from Edinburgh, there might be good reasons for them to join by video link. But I would be inclined to keep that restricted. But how you draw those lines is a really difficult question, I think, for everybody. If we say that some virtual participation is allowable and healthy, where do you draw the line and how do you prevent those lines constantly getting stretched? Because I'm sure that a lot of ministers would love to never show up in Parliament because it's quite a tough environment and you don't want to be able to slip to that position.
Thank you. Dr. Fox?
One of the things that members often say is they want to be able to see the whites of ministers' eyes in the chamber or in committee and have that in-person engagement. But I think you have to think about, again, going back to short-term, long-term implications and criteria, and whether criteria are permissive or restrictive. Ministers are also members of the House, of the Chamber, and you know, they too can get ill, they too may have to isolate, they too may have work-life balance issues and so on. So the question is whether the principle of equity of treatment applies to them in the same way as it applies to other members, or whether that's superseded by the advantages derived from in-person scrutiny. And it's a delicate balance, and I don't think you can reach a perfect solution. And, you know, then perhaps...
Apologies, Dr. Fox, we seem to be losing the line, so I think we're going to try with just audio. So,
hello?
Do you want to try now?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now.
I'm not sure at what point you lost me, but I think this rather proves the point about some of the difficulties. I'm not sure where you lost me, but I was saying that. You know, ministers are also members, and they too, can get ill. They can have to isolate. They've got work-life balance issues as well as other members. And what would come into play is the principle of equity of treatment. Do you treat ministers differently to other members? Is there a kind of pragmatic solution where, as a normal practice, ministers do have to be present, but in exceptional circumstances, leave would be granted by a committee convener or by the presiding officer for them to is there a consensus among members that of what would constitute, if you like, a reasonable excuse? Weather or travel problems, yes, perhaps family responsibilities, illness, isolation, but clashing ministerial duties or clashing constituency commitments, would that be sufficient? Debate would have to around what would be an acceptable reason for the minister not to be present?
I think that I take you on equity for members and for ministers. I think the point I was trying to make is ministers and cabinet secretaries are adept at knowing, because the clerks tell them when they're going to have to start at the committee and usually when they're going to end. They therefore can judge the amount of questions they can. And they will take a long time to answer a specific question that they want to, and try and talk the other questions out. I've seen it as a convener in the committee, and at one stage as convener, I had to cut off the microphone of one cabinet secretary who wouldn't shut up so the other members of the committee could speak. So that's the point I was trying to make. My second point was just, I want to push back slightly, and I want to understand slightly more about the party aspect of it. I'll be perfectly clear that I'm a deputy whip for my party, and it slightly concerns me, and I was interested to hear about why you think it shouldn't be parties that control speaking slots, because they do, because we're given a certain amount of slots for every debate, and how we would get around that to make sure that those people who are virtual all get equity, because there is no doubt about it, if you are virtual in the Scottish Parliament, you only get to speak when you've got a speaking slot. You can't intervene, you can't do anything. And I know, Convener, you say it's going to happen. I'll believe it when I see it. So I'd quite like Meg's views on that, if I may, please.
Yeah, I think there's another interesting trade-off here, isn't there, which Ruth alluded to, that if you don't continue experimenting with the technology, you're never going to find the solutions to allow the spontaneity that we're currently lacking. But of course, we only, you know, there was some phenomenal development by people behind the scenes in parliaments in the UK and around the world to get these arrangements up and running. But it was only done through pure necessity if we don't need it, maybe we're not going to prioritise making it work in quite the same way, which is really quite a kind of conundrum. Well, I come back to what I said at the beginning, that I don't know enough about the standard day-to-day working of the Scottish Parliament to know to what extent the parties do have control over who gets to speak, etc. now. Certainly at Westminster, the parties have very little control because the Speaker chooses people in debate. But yes, you saw realisation of that. I mean, we saw in the House of Commons speaker lists for the first time ever, there being a much more kind of fixed and preordained list of who is going to intervene in the debate by necessity because of the virtual arrangements, which some people have been pressing for that for years, actually, that we should move to that kind of system, which exists in other parliaments. To me, it's a shame if you lose the spontaneity of people being able to stand up and respond to each other. You know, it makes the debate, debates are always a little bit artificial. People clearly do arrive with their, you know, pre-written remarks and so on, but you remove any hope, really, that it is a proper debate where one person will stand up and respond to what a person before has said if you have these preordained lists. And certainly, I've been present at Westminster when, you know, somebody's seen something in their office and wanted to rush to the chamber to leap into the debate and that kind of thing. You lose that with some people being guaranteed that they've got involvement from not being on site. And it's very difficult, I think, to move towards the kind of spontaneity that we're used to in parliaments and that I think is sort of part of their lifeblood, really.
I think, Professor, certainly the discussion of the quality of the debate in the Scottish Parliament is as loud and vociferous as it is in Westminster. Dr. Fox, have you got any comments about Edward's question?
I think you can think about the management of the system, if you like, at different levels. So the if you deploy restrictive criteria, who manages that? Who certifies it if some form of certification is required? Should that be the parties or should that be the speaker, presiding officer, a cross-party body? For political parties, I can imagine for members it might be quite difficult if there are personal reasons or health reasons that they don't want the party whips to know about, that there could be an issue there. But that might naturally rest better with the presiding officer, or you have a system of self-certification. Which proceedings does it apply to, hybrid participation? Does it apply to all proceedings or does it apply to only particular types of proceedings? So the forms of proceeding that work best on virtual model, so questions, statements and so on, but not perhaps legislative proceedings. We had that at Westminster for a time. Who decides that? It was decided there in effect at Westminster by the government, and it led to a fairly toxic atmosphere because they moved from an approach of consensus through representatives of the parties and the Speaker through the House of Commons Commission, the government deciding what should happen, and that being problematic. Then Parliament has, in terms of its procedures and in terms of the powers of the Speaker or, you know, the presiding officer, whoever is in the chair. And certainly at Westminster, there have been issues about the, with the best will in the world, the need to orchestrate proceedings to a degree through call lists has limited the powers of the Speaker to adjust things during the course of a debate. So if somebody doesn't turn up online to participate, they drop off the system altogether. If a debate finishes early, what do you do about using up the time at the end of the debate that's been set aside? Do they have the option to offer that speaking time to other people? So, you know, there, I think, in terms of actual activity in the chamber, I think enhancing the powers of the Speaker more flexibly manage business would be helpful. And that's not something that's been true of all parliaments. There hasn't been an adjustment of procedures sometimes and the rules on the powers of the Speaker to take account of that.
Thank you, Dr. Fox. I'm very conscious of time. But to sort of err back to one of the professor's earlier comments, both of your contributions have been incredibly useful and valuable, as contributions are. So can I thank you both for your attendance today? And I hope you follow our inquiry, if simply to learn a little bit more about the Scottish Parliament, but perhaps to find a way a different legislature is looking at the hybrid Parliament and how we move forward. But can I once again express on my behalf and the committee's my thanks for your attendance this morning. Thank you. I will now suspend the meeting briefly so that we can change over for witnesses. Thank you. Can I welcome people back to this, the 10th meeting, and this is our second evidence session based on future parliamentary procedure and practice inquiry that the committee is undertaking. And I would like to welcome Dr. Sarah Childs from the Royal Holloway University of London, and also Dr. Andy Williamson from Democratise, who is joining us online. Can I thank you for your attendance this morning? My intention is just to sort of move into questions from the committee with the hope that we can develop a sort of conversation about certain themes that have come from the committee's evidence that we've received so far. So I'm going to pass you both into the more than capable hands of Colette Stevenson. Colette.
And good morning, Dr. Childs. Just to give you a bit of insight, we were talking earlier in the earlier committee. I was newly elected in May last year, and prior to that, and I still am a councillor within South Lanarkshire. And the reason why I wanted to touch upon that was because of my own experience of working, hybrid, virtual, and being here in person as well. So it was all I'd ever known. So it was like the Marie Celeste, basically, when you came in here. And it's a shame because it is a public building, so there should be people in here. And it's lovely to have them back in as well. And obviously, as well, having the experience of being a councillor, it was great because I didn't have that peer support when I came in as such. So having drawn on the experience from being a councillor was great. So I don't know what it would have been like for other newly elected members who didn't have that experience. Anyway, I just wanted to sort of explore with you more the sort of challenges and the opportunities of having a digital parliament as well. And just to maybe explore how successful the Scottish Parliament's transition to the sort of hybrid virtual working methods, and also if you could maybe touch upon you know, how we measure that success as well, and any sort of mitigating factors as well that have maybe presented themselves, and as I say, that could include examples of like the limits in terms of technology and maybe people grasping that technology as well. And so I'll leave it to you to touch upon that. Thanks.
Dr. Childs, if we can come to you first.
Yes, thank you. And I should say that I'm drawing on research that I also undertook with Jessica Smith from the University of Southampton, just to make that clear. And also my work is predominantly based on Westminster and through a gender-sensitive and diversity-sensitive parliaments approach. So I think much of what you said I would agree with. I think very few people are advocating for completely virtual institutions that are empty of people. I think from a diversity perspective, it's about exploring the possibilities to perhaps better balance the difficulties some people will have in participating in a completely physical institution and weighing up what advantages one can get from enabling hybridity. From a diversity perspective, enabling people perhaps who cannot travel for whatever reason or who cannot necessarily be in an institution 5 days in a row or the number of days that you're present in any 1 week. So I think for me, that's the really central point, that really one needs to be clear about whether there's any meaningful detriment. And that might be at the individual level, but it also might be at the institutional level. So it could be that there are individual advantages of hybridity, notwithstanding what you said. And I think you're absolutely right. I think it would be disingenuous to suggest that the in-person and the informal is not acutely critical to how well one can do the job. At the same time, it might be at the institutional level that the quality of scrutiny and advocacy would be enhanced by some members being able to participate in a hybrid way so that they are actually present. So there's that tension between inclusion and a diverse inclusion and those voices not being present if one closed down hybridity. So I think that is what institutions need to explore. And you talked about measurement, and I think that can be through surveys of members, and I've seen some of the results. But I think it's also about exploring possibilities, because the technological abilities of institutions rapidly, and again, I'm no technological expert, but from what I've read about many parliaments, the technology happened very quickly, and it seems to me that parliaments should be thinking about future-proofing their technology. So where some of the concerns around socialisation and the informal and spontaneity and debate have been linked to a lack of technological ability, it seems to me that increasingly the argument is that that could be enhanced in the future. So maybe an institution looking to the future should be exploring those potentials. So maybe there could be new moments of informal interaction between individuals. So I take all of what you're saying, but I want to bring in that alternative reading to see what can be advanced through technological solutions, but also to recognise that it's a balance between the individual participation and the institutional efficacy, effectiveness, representation, and the quality of all of those. So I'm very much in favour of a permissive situation where some of those questions are explored technologically to see what could happen.
Okay, no, thanks very much.
Dr. Williamson, I understand that there's slight problems with your connection, so it'll be an audio contribution, which hopefully we'll be able to hear clearer. Dr. Williamson?
Thank you, Matt and Var. I'm joining you from the Isle of Skye, so sometimes our broadband infrastructure isn't quite up to par. I apologise for that. It was working fine earlier. But I think as we pointed out earlier, and Ruth Fox said in the earlier session, this is a classic example of when we're trying to do things in hybrid mode that technology gets in the way. You can always guarantee it. A couple of things I want to say around Colette's question. First of all is, with four people giving evidence in the session and three are experts in Westminster, and we have to stop in Scotland looking at Westminster as a model for the Scottish Parliament. It's so different. It's so substantially different that there are better parliaments that we can look at to learn from. And I think that's an important point moving forward. The Scottish Parliament is a very different thing to Westminster. Also, when we're talking about the future of Parliament and what Parliament looks like, we've spoken so far today about the members in the chamber, but we are ignoring the wider aspect here, which is the technological revolution that we've experienced and which has accelerated massively in the last 2 years as a result of the pandemic and things that parliaments have had to do, actually changes the fundamental fabric of how Parliament works. It transforms Parliament into digital-first institutions where our legislative management systems are better, our communication systems are better, our ability to be open and to connect with the public is enhanced. There are opportunities as well as challenges. But Edward made a very strong point in the previous session. The technology removes the human interaction. And that's a real challenge. So, you know, we don't want to go to a purely digital parliament. We need that face-to-face. And I was in the Australian Parliament a number of years ago with the clerk there, and she said, Parliament happens when we come together. And my response was, yes, but what about when we can't? What about the points in between? What about members who live in more remote constituencies? I mean, for me to get from Skye to Edinburgh is a significant drive. It would take an overnight stop. I wouldn't want to do that drive there and back in a day and give evidence. Much easier than I can do it this way. If I want to talk to my Member of Parliament or MSP, how are they going to spend time in the constituency if they have to be in the Parliament all the time? So I think we can look at balances there. Looking at access as well, what we've seen over the pandemic, I've worked with about 50 parliaments in the last 2 years, but primarily about pandemic response. But actually, that shifted from the enforced innovation of the first 3 to 6 months into a settling down period and the identification of strategic opportunities to modernise Parliament. And where we're at now is very much looking at the strategic opportunities. How do we strengthen Parliament and how do we do it differently? And Norway, for example, moved to virtual committees and hybrid committees. And the response from their civil society sector was that this was great because it actually improved access to committees for civil society groups who were not based in Oslo, not based close to the parliaments, and had to travel considerable distances. And that was a barrier to giving evidence, a barrier to being heard. So I think if we look at this whole thing holistically, we can see there are some challenges because we're still looking backwards at how Parliament used to work. We're still coming to grips with the technology. And I think Colette asked about how the Scottish Parliament has responded. And I've worked with around 50 parliaments, and the Scottish Parliament has done very, very well. You've moved very quickly. You've modified procedure to be flexible. You've now got a continuity plan in place that if you have to, you can switch to a virtual model, and you're running hybrid committees. I think that's excellent. I think you should be very pleased with what you've done, but we can do more. And we are just at the base of the mountain. We're learning new ways of doing Parliament, if you like. So I think this is the place to start this conversation is, what does Parliament look like in 10 years' time? What do we want it to be? Do we want it to be more representative? Do we want it to be more open and accessible? And do we want it to be more co-creative and collaborative with citizens? I think they're all big questions.
Thank you, Dr. Williamson. I'm going to do that sensitive convener moment by reassuring you that we are taking substantial amounts of evidence both from other legislatures and indeed other people who hold expertise in the Scottish Parliament. I think as a committee and every MSP recognises that the privilege of the Scottish Parliament is not measured by the fact that it's not Westminster, but by the fact that it is the Parliament for the people of Scotland, and that's why we're here. But thank you for that contribution. Colette.
Thanks very much, Convener. Yeah, I mean, you sort of kind of answered my next question to a degree in terms of what other legislators are doing and you know, what lessons can we pick up from that as well, and maybe what mistakes we've made as well. And in terms of a digital parliament, and it means working more in hybrids for proceedings and things like what sort of related issues should the Scottish Parliament be considering, do you think, for the future? Because you mentioned it as well about in 10 years' time. And we talked about spontaneity, and also I'm very big on tone as well. And I actually mentioned it last night at the Engender event that we had in person. And in terms of how we learn more from, and I'm going to be quite controversial here and talk about misogyny and the tone, particularly with men, especially in our chamber as well, and how we can actually maybe tone that down, if you like, because it can be quite intimidating for a lot of women MSPs.
Dr. Child?
Okay, sorry, just sorting out my technology, which has nothing to do with hybridity, just me. I mean, I absolutely agree. Unfortunately, I found myself being Zoom-bombed or something with misogynistic drawings last week, so I think there are concerns that we must make sure don't happen when we go online, but I absolutely feel that the tone of politics needs to be much more respectful and inclusionary, and that we need, if we're in a hybrid mode, to be able to moderate behaviour, as we do, and perhaps need to do more so in person too. So I think the sort of violence against women in politics, which is increasingly recognised globally, is something that all parliaments need to take seriously. And I think there are efforts to do that, and some of that is about training, and some of that is about a culture of an institution and signalling and leadership, and ultimately sexual harassment and bullying procedures and processes of accountability. So I think all of those kind of issues need to be taken seriously as well. In terms of some of the concerns around hybridity, I think the question of the extent to which moving to hybridity raises issues of executive dominance and the ability for governments to control time and to control space and interaction, I think those are very, very important. I also think it really matters that the public feel that they are part of any process rather than observing what happens to an institution. So things change and they're not aware of what's going on. So I think public engagement around developments about where the Parliament in 10 years might be going, it seems to me, should include public discussions so that they feel it's development, or Parliament is developing with them, as opposed to them merely being subject to what's decided. And of course, in a pandemic situation, those decisions had to be quick, had to be in many ways, not with the public. But I think moving forward, that really, I didn't mean to use that phrase, is really, really important. It matters also, I think, that I'm going to use the term the ordinary member of an institution also feels that they are party to discussions and developments. I think sometimes parliaments can leave people behind and feel that some people, in whether that's in a bureau or by the speaker, and I think that really matters too, so that people don't feel that an institution is leaving them silent. The biggest thing, I think, about hybridity is to really take on that question of opportunities. Committee witnesses, of course, fantastic. We do need to see evidence that. In your first question, I'm not sure that either of us necessarily addresses. I think we need monitoring, and I think we need data. And if you look at the United Nations COVID-19 Parliament's checklist, actually really ensuring that we see how whatever changes is subject to review, monitoring, update, revisions. And I think you need a process to capture the difference this makes, because if we find that some of these new ways of working end up being discriminatory against certain types, and we create second-class MSPs, or we find that geography is meaning that some MSPs are not having the same opportunities, I think all of those are really important. So I would also really stress the importance of review, monitoring and reform, because some of the practices that may look at, on first blush as positive may over time not be. And I think it also matters, and this will be my final point on this, that we think of the institution as a total institution and recognise the impact of whatever happens on the staff, and that we also need to be very aware of what the implications might be for them as well and their opportunities to excel and to have fair and just working conditions.
Thank you, Dr. Charles. Dr. Williamson?
I think I'll leave Sarah's answer standing. That's her area of expertise rather than mine. But I completely agree with that. And the only thing I will say is, we know from experience, we know from research that digital makes abuse and discrimination worse, and we do have to overcome it. But that's not just an issue for Parliament, that's an issue at the societal level.
That's very helpful, Dr. Williamson. Colette?
I've got no further questions.
That's excellent. Edward, can I pass over to you?
Yes, thank you, Convener. And can I just say at the outset, I have some sympathy with Andy driving from Skye to Parliament in one day, which I've done on numerous occasions because I cover it. It's quite a flog, especially if you get behind a timber lorry. And I think that Sarah's point about government control of time is actually valid. But let's be clear, the government do control the time because they control the Bureau and they can say exactly how long each debate's going to be, whether there'll be a ministerial statement. And none of the members have any say in it, and it's something I think that we ought to consider a little bit more, because we had a situation on Tuesday this week when the Bureau met, and debate was scheduled for Thursday, was pinned by the government, and they just changed it unilaterally. I think it's disrespectful to the Parliament, having programmed it in 3 weeks ago or 2 weeks ago. So my question really is twofold. I take Sarah's point, and I think Andy's point, that you both made about witnesses giving evidence at committees, and I think the hybrid system is really, really good for that. So I want to go to the chamber system, and I want to ask you both whether you think the way the chamber comes across in a hybrid system is open and transparent. So perhaps, Sarah, you'd like to lead off on that, and then Andy come in on it.
Again, I wouldn't want to speak beyond my experience of Westminster on this issue, so I'll leave that to Dr. Williamson. But I do think we need to measure public perceptions, but also member perceptions on this, because it kind of goes back to where Dr. Williamson started, is that he was having some technological issues, but he was still here, and actually we would have lost his voice if he wasn't able perhaps to get in that car and drive. So I think it's about a public conversation as well as an institutional conversation about what makes for an effective chamber moment, and to recognising there might be different ways, different performances, perhaps varied to the actual business in hand, and to recognise that, perhaps the historic way we might imagine what makes for a good chamber moment can be enhanced, critiqued, or just be done differently. I think we sometimes imagine that the good parliamentarian, wherever they are, has a particular style. And actually, we can transform that, and we transform that by having different people interacting in different ways. So, of course, again, I'm not in favour of, very long speeches, for example, where people aren't able to interrupt, or you feel that you're being spoken at rather than it being discursive or a dialogue. Deliberation. I think all of those are really important principles of chamber moments. But I do think we can recognise that members in any parliament can do their job differently and be good parliamentarians. And I think that's something that perhaps we haven't talked about as a society, because we have those very traditional views of the speech-making elder statesman of an institution. And I'd like to think in newer institutions we can be more diverse in the way that the good parliamentarian is recognised as taking many forms.
Thank you. Professor Williamson?
I think it's an interesting question. I mean, first of all, we have to go back to what's the culture of the chamber. A few months back, I was speaking to the Bundestag, and this subject came up, and I made the point that one of the criticisms in Westminster has been that the debate loses spontaneity. And the Germans thought this was fantastic because they don't want spontaneity. They want to be the next one on the list to be called to speak. And you don't interrupt and you don't heckle. And same in Spain. In Scotland, we have a system of debate. We have a responsive, interactive debate. And I think, you know, for all my promotion of digital transformation, and I think hybrid is a great idea, and certainly in an emergency situation, it's absolutely vital, it does not replace the plenary. Around the world, we saw in the research that I've been doing with the Interparliamentary Union, the Centre for Innovation in Parliament, so 66% of parliaments using hybrid or virtual tools for committees, only 33% for plenary. And one of the reasons for that is it just does not replicate. It's too difficult to have spontaneous debate. Interactions, as already mentioned in this session, are immensely challenging. So it only really works in a parliamentary system where you have speaker lists and a very ordered structure with no interruption. And then it's business as usual, in effect. So in Brazil, for example, the hybrid system is working very, very effectively. In fact, it's almost a virtual system, apart from a couple of people. Almost everybody is attending virtually in the plenary, in the Chamber of Deputies. So that's great. But I think in the Scottish Parliament, I don't think it's an effective replacement. I think it's a business continuity tool that we have in case of an emergency. Now, if a member wishes to participate and can't physically participate, then there is an opportunity to do that. The House of Lords has allowed, I think, 20 members to participate remotely in the plenary. But it's a second-class experience for the member, and I think we have to be clear about that. I think it's a second-class experience for democracy as well, because if we're in a discursive chamber, without the ability to have dynamic interventions, it can't function. So I think we have to reserve largely the plenary for exceptional circumstances in hybrid mode. But actually, committees are very different. And I think we have to separate plenary and committee. I think committees are much more suited to the hybrid mode than the plenary is.
Thank you, Dr. Williamson. Edward?
Yeah, I'd say, Andy, if I may, it's not a second-class experience. Having done it for a year, it's a fourth-class experience, because I just don't feel that I've been given any chance to get into the Parliament as much as I would like to, as far as talking in the chamber. No interventions, no chance of interventions, no interactions with other members. Can't see what anyone's saying. I see a clock on my face on the screen. There are so many things wrong with it that this Parliament, I think, would be at a loss for it. My next question, though, is to both of you, is that I think you're both saying that the hybrid system for committee works, for chambers it might not work. What pressure does it put on the rest of the Parliament, though, the hybrid system, as far as if you're not there and you can't ask questions in the chamber, as far as asking written questions to the government or questions to the government? Do you think the hybrid system puts a pressure on the Parliament out with the chamber and the committees because it's hybrid? That's my question. I don't know, Andy, if you want to head off on that, and then Sarah, or the other way around. If Sarah, you're on the screen, it's probably easier.
Okay. Thank you. And I would just like to follow up, if it's okay, on your previous comments. And I think, you know, I don't want to dispute that it feels very secondary or fourth class, as you say, but I would want to go back to the fact that the alternative might be that you're absent and that your voice isn't heard and that the people you represent aren't heard. And I think that's, for me, the bottom line. And it's that balance between effectively being excluded from certain parts of a parliament because the format means that you cannot be present. And it might be that for a period of time, that actually having a fourth class or a second class experience is still better for yourself and those you represent. And I think it's about exploring the technological possibilities, because in the research that I'm reading on parliaments and their responses, I think there is a concern that the immediate technology shouldn't be where we think the future might be. And actually, the ability to interact with others may well be better. And perhaps we should be trialling some of this. I think that's the other thing, because it is a public institution and you want to ensure that the best is in place, we perhaps are a little bit risk-averse and we don't try in certain plenary sessions modes of more spontaneous interaction because we risk and we're concerned about a public perception of a failing institution or a poor quality debate. But maybe we should actually trial some of these and actually see what is possible. And then that then obviously leads, sorry, more directly to your question about the stresses and strains. I think, again, from the interactions I've had with parliamentary clerks and officials, that clearly this was an immensely stressful period. People were working very long hours at distance to create solutions. And I think we have to recognise the ongoing difficulties of working remotely as House staff in providing the support and the relocation of people for different jobs that they're doing, perhaps that other aspects of the work of a parliament may have been slightly parked in order to support hybridity. So I think there are questions on the organisation and the funding of particular services within a parliament that would need to be reviewed. I think we also need to explore the potential for there being inequalities in terms of those who come into a parliament and or who work remotely and where we might want to see post the pandemic situation, flexible working and remote working for parliamentary staff. I'd be very concerned that we miss the opportunity to monitor what's going on so we, again, don't create inequalities between those who are present and those who are absent as well. So I think there are issues around technology, around personnel and their own career possibilities, if you like, that might be hung over. And I think I would also, and perhaps this is, I hope this is appropriate, actually the stresses and strains of parliamentary staff, and actually it's been a very intense period for those, and to recognise that emergency mode cannot go on forever. So I think those are the kind of points I would really stress to you on those issues.
Thank you, Professor Charles. Dr. Williamson, can I just add slightly to Edward's question about where the strains are out with the Chamber by saying, is there also a need for perhaps MSPs to learn different skills in taking or obtaining information from the government, and will technology make that easier?
I think that's a great additional question. could be answered in a number of ways. Come back to Edward's question. I think what we're seeing here is a change of process and a change of culture. We do have to find different ways of doing things if we're working in a different environment. I think the reality is we're going to go back to something that looks 80% like it did, and then there'll be some other things that we've learned along the way that are beneficial. Sarah made a really good point about supporting staff, and I think this is, again, one of the things that gets lost under the water of the bottom of the iceberg, this has been a massively traumatic time for staff as well, having to work remotely. At one point, the Brazilian Chamber of Deputies had about 90% of its staff working remotely, including its IT staff, who had to run the systems that were in the Parliament building. And so it had to do major, major structural and cultural changes to make these things work. In South Africa, what they found is they've paired up their IT staff with members a lot more closely. Because members have had to be supported to get up to speed with using the tools that are available to them. And so they've developed much stronger relationships. And the spin-off has been, actually, they've overcome issues of trust. And one of the big issues we've seen with parliaments in the last 2 years is trust in the technology. I don't know how to use it. I don't know what these tools are. Are they safe? Is this conversation confidential? Can it be hacked? Is someone going to hack what I'm doing? And the parliamentary IT staff around the world have worked very, very hard to reassure members, to train them, and to build their levels of confidence. And the reaction to that we're now seeing is much higher levels of understanding of the technology and much higher levels of trust in the tools that they have, which is very, very positive. Do we need to learn different ways of doing things? Well, maybe we do. Maybe we need to rethink. The parliamentary system is not perfect and it's not static. So we always have the opportunity to iteratively redesign parts of it. And perhaps the The two sides of, well, three sides of this. It's Parliament's relationship with itself. So how does it function itself? What are the tools and systems and practices and cultures that are going on internally? What is its relationship with the public? How does it interact? How does it share open data? How does it open publish? How does it convene co-creative events or do more deliberative events that involve the public in decision making? And the third aspect is, what is its relationship with the executive? And that's both holding the executive to account, but also the background correspondence that goes on, the communication, et cetera, et cetera. And I think we're not sure what that looks like yet. I think we're still, in a way, coming out of the crisis. So we've still got that post-viral situation where we're still trying to get our heads around it. What it will look like in 5 or 10 years' time, I don't know. I'm not sure. But I think it is an opportunity for some conversations about how we remodel those communication channels and those networks and those tools. And what is the most effective way for Parliament to hold the executive to account in the modern digital age?
Thank you. And thank you, Edward. I'm going to pass over to Bob now. Bob?
Thank you, Convener. Really interesting discussion. I was partly taken with Dr. Chell's talking about the technology we have today. The immediate is not the future. And I think Dr. Child's and Dr. Williams have been very strong about looking forward where we want Parliament to be. One of the things we want Parliament to be is more accessible for existing MSPs. I'll come on to look, people who may stand for election in the future. Mm-hmm. There's a whole list of groups we could talk about. It could be women, it could be carers, it could be parents, it could be disabled, it could be those remote and rural, it could be BAME members of the community. So I suppose I'm keen to get a flavour of what both witnesses think the opportunities are in relation to making those MSPs we currently have who may have those characteristics to get that better balance in their life and greater accessibility to Parliament as things stand, or perhaps in the future. And I should note, because my briefing here talks about unintended consequences mm-hmm. as well, because with every upside there could be a downside. So any comments from both witnesses in relation to that would be very helpful. Maybe Dr. Childs. Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think there's a huge opportunity. If you transform the conditions under which parliamentarians can undertake their work, it can transform perceptions of, of an institution being open and facilitating presence and effective participation. So I think that really matters, and it can be both symbolic, as in signalling that this is a role model institution, that it is leading society by being a place that is for everybody. But I think it also, as you suggest, can have really substantive benefits. So about how effective you as an MSP can do your job, given your particular circumstances. And one of the things that I think is really important about enabling individuals to participate as elected members is that we don't look for individual solutions, or we don't look to have informal, opaque solutions. But we actually think, as an institution, what is required and how do we work from a basis that one is entitled to undertake work differently without that being seen as substandard or off-putting to others. I mean, historically, women have had to juggle motherhood, and it was dealt with privately with your own party, and that raises questions both of parity. If you're, you know, if you're not favoured by the whips, will you be able to get this kind of arrangement? But more than that, it's really patronising to have to go and ask for an individual solution, whereas the institution should be an enabling institution. So I think hybridity, a permissive hybridity, enables the sort of a right to participate that we would see in many other places of work. And I think that matters because this is a public place of democracy, really signalling that whatever your circumstances, the institution will do its best to be open to you. And I think that is very much about all of the groups that you said. But I think it's really about creating that parity, that fundamental right to participate in politics. And that should be an equality that's really essential to a healthy democracy.
Okay. That's helpful. And Dr. Williamson, your response would be helpful, and perhaps whether going forward we have to conduct equality impact assessments in whether that's before we evolve our hybrid parliament or whether, as you mentioned, and there's an iterative process where we measure these things in real time. Dr. Williamson.
I think you do have to look at the impact on different groups in society. We have to look at representation. The Scottish Parliament is not the worst in any sense in terms of its representativeness, but it's not very good. Not many parliaments are. This is not a unique challenge for Scotland. There are major challenges, and anything that we can do to make Parliament more accessible to more people, it's that thing that we want our representatives to look like us, but they don't, unless you're a white middle-aged male, which I am, but you know, they don't. And that has to change. So how can we make that change? We can enable people, and Sarah's summed it up really well, we can enable people to work more in their ways around their lives, around childcare, around caring responsibilities, around where you live. Right now we're in the we're just coming to the end of lambing. So there's a 2-week period here where it's flat out with lambing. That, you know, it's a very unique situation for someone that lives in a croft. How do you do that? Well, hybridity is one way of doing it, being able to join the session where you are without having to travel is good. Also, hybridity, by the way, is good for the environment. If we're, you know, in Scotland, we're a big country with a lot of rural people, and having to travel from Antalyaskina to Dunedin to a meeting is crazy. Oh, why should I have to travel to Edinburgh when I can do it remotely? I mean, getting the amount of CO2 I'm emitting just getting to the meeting, never mind what I'm saying in the meeting. So it's not just hybridity, it's also access to the information. How do I get access to the information for this in a timely way? If the time that I have to read the papers for the session tomorrow is at 11 o'clock at night when the kids are in bed and I've finally got a bit of time to myself, then I want to be able to access it. I don't want to have to go to a print office and collect it. I want it on my laptop or my iPad. I want it in front of me. I want the agenda in a timely way. So I want to know that these are the sessions that I need to be at, and I can schedule my time around them and know where I can physically be present, because that is important, but also know when it's beneficial because of family commitments, because of health, because of constituency work or something else, that actually it's more effective for my job as a representative not to be physically present.
Thank you.
I was going to say, and there's also the big issue of the communication beyond that. How do we have Parliament seen? You know, it's not just about being more open and accessible on the inside. It's about being more visible on the outside. So how do we make Parliament more visible on the outside, so it's less of a barrier to people who want to get involved but don't feel it's for them?
Thank you, Dr. Williamson. I'll do one final question on this. I had asked about unintended negative consequences of hybrid as well. I'm minded that I was doing a hybrid conference, and we used a platform called Remo, which I won't go into, but it was fantastic in allowing people to table hop and mingle with each other. So it's about what the unintended negative consequences might be, but how those can be mitigated against. And I'm conscious we've heard a lot about those informal chats that can't happen unless it's face-to-face, and nothing replaces face-to-face, but there are mitigations that can put in place. So anything in relation to unintended negative consequences, what mitigations can be put in place? And I was supposed to ask about whether these reforms will make it more likely that people from underrepresented groups will stand for election. It was remiss of me not to ask that in my initial question, and I won't come back in after that, convener. Dr. Childs.
Thank you. And I think sometimes when you're reading members' views on their experiences, we need to sometimes think that you are those who have successfully negotiated the barriers that exclude others. So sometimes when we look at evidence supporting particular modes of participation, we might not be surveying the right people. So I think that's also really important. You're here, you have your experiences, but there's a whole swathe of people out there who might think differently if they had been asked. And I think that's really important in terms of getting access to information about what might improve the institution. The unintended consequences, I remember a long time ago now when I sort of started looking at sort of recruitment, is that you know, you can easily imagine a situation where you have actually the successful people rising up the ranks of a political party within an institution as being those who are present all the time, who still go to the bars in the evening and do all of the kind of historic presenteeism activities, the informal, the socialising, who don't have to go home and do the caring or don't have to travel home a long way. And so that is a significant risk. I don't think it's necessarily one that should stop the practice, but it must be monitored to see what's happening, because what you could imagine is the young thrusting men getting all of the institutional leadership positions and the executive positions and anybody else staying perhaps more at home and not having those opportunities. I think we have to think about rules and formal moments of informality, and I know that sounds ridiculous, but we know that members use WhatsApp a lot to communicate, but that's not something that, if you're not already included, you're not going to be able to participate in. But it seems to me, if you think about the moments that are critical to an effective institution, whether that's the bumping in to ministers in a corridor or in party meetings, we need to ensure that the moments that currently are really important in person can be artificially created. So we almost need to plan for some of those, so that online we might have a period where some ministers are sort of informally having coffee online, if that makes sense, that people could then phone into or participate in. So, again, I'm not a virtual reality type expert, but it seems to me that it shouldn't be beyond the wit of those who are to create those informal moments, the happenstance, the water cooler moment. And they can, I think, be timetabled in. Academic conferences do exactly what you were talking about, where you have those opportunities in some of the best ones to nip in and have a coffee with people, to decide during a conversation you want to meet with a few people afterwards. So it's about structuring days, schedules, creating those informal moments online, because without that you will get exclusionary practices and patterns, I think.
Thank you. And Dr. Williamson?
Yeah, I think everything that Sarah just said. I'm slightly dubious about creating the artificial virtual spaces, because I always find they're very contrived. But, you know, let's think where we're going. We're looking at the metaverse. And do we have Parliament in the metaverse? I mean, it sounds horrific, but maybe it isn't. Maybe it does work. I don't know. But there's a very, very basic thing we've got to drop back to here, is that in the real world, the Scottish Parliament has spent a lot of time making it accessible. Let's not remove that by being digital and creating digital barriers. We have to make sure that all of the digital tools are accessible, that they work with screen readers, that they work for people with disabilities. And we have to look at the digital deficit. We don't have equality of broadband or 5G access across Scotland, as I'm testament to today. We have to make sure that if we're going to have universal participation in a democratic process, we have universal access to digital tools at the same level. So we can't replace physical barriers to access with digital barriers to access.
Thank you.
Is that everything, Bob?
Yes,
thank you. Yeah. I think that's a very useful note to put at the end there, Dr. Williamson, about ensuring that we don't artificially create barriers with an inevitable move to digital. Well, with certainly an enthusiastic move to digital, that we don't end up excluding other groups in that way, which is very helpful. I suppose my final question was written as, what are the advantages of virtual proceedings? But I'd like to change that slightly from listening to the evidence of both sessions today and ask both of you whether we should be afraid of virtual change, or whether we should be brave enough to take risks, which is in part why this Parliament was originally founded, and because of its closeness to the people of Scotland and to our constituents, and the fact that they have such an important part of it, that we find ways to bring them on. So should we be scared of this change, or should we embrace it? And we may make mistakes, but the end goal is more advantageous. Professor Charles?
I think democracies around the world are under attack by authoritarian and anti-democratic forces. Trust in politics is a big issue. I think we have to defend representative democracy and to defend it, we have to design better ways of doing it. And I think that has to involve technology for the reasons we've just all lived through, but also because it has got those potentials to really fundamentally get at that question of political equality, of access, participation, influence. And that really matters to how a healthy democracy works. And I think a successful parliament is a very good counterpoint to those who say representative democracy in decline and we should have authoritarian leaders, if not despots. So I think we have to embrace it. And I think you're right, a conversation about not always knowing how best to design, but having a very clear sense of what you're trying to achieve and to recognise that some practices may be suboptimal and will then be left behind. But I think that idea of not having a static institution, but one that is prepared, perhaps under conditions where you have time-limited trials or trials in some areas, so you don't have to be in revolutionary mode, but you can be in incremental change mode that over time can really bring about strong changes in a much healthier democracy. So I would really encourage the idea of thinking about institutions. And we talked a lot about culture in the background today, and I'm increasingly of the view that you have to design for changes in culture, just talking about wanting a different culture. I don't think culture just happens. I think you have to intervene to bring about changes in institutions. So I think signalling where you want to be, what kind of parliament and what kind of representative democracy you want here, is a way of signalling that cultural change. And then rule change and practice change can really be mutually sort of conducive with that.
That's helpful, Professor Charles. Dr. Williamson?
I'm loving having Sarah go before me because she's saying everything I want to say and saying it so well that I can just add little bits on the end. So I completely agree with all of that. Should you be afraid of virtual change? Well, yes, because it will challenge you. Should you be brave enough to create change? No, you should be brave enough to lead change. You are our foremost democratic institution in Scotland. And I'd like to see you be more radical. I'd like to see you make mistakes. Mistakes are the only way to learn. If you're not making mistakes, you're not doing enough. Chile, the Chilean Chamber of Deputies, is one of my favourite parliaments that I work with at the moment, and they took the decision to be agile. So everything they do is now agile. It's a minimum viable product that they roll out to get something working, and then they test it and they play with it and they get members to use it, then they do another bit, and sometimes it doesn't work, they roll it back. Sometimes it does, they roll it forward. And it's a different attitude. But you as an institution have these big monolithic project management frameworks and procurement frameworks that will stop you being agile, that will stop you being innovative. And part of this being brave is challenge those. Challenge the way you procure technology. Challenge the way that you run projects. Do it differently. Be prepared to take big goals and aim towards them, but do it in small iterative steps and roll it back if it doesn't work, when it doesn't work, and learn from it. This is a conversation. And as Sarah said, there are huge challenges to representative democracy. You are not a loved institution. No parliament is, and it's a fact of life. And many of the reasons for that, for people like myself who work in parliaments, are frustrating because a lot of it is bad representation in a biased media. And we have problems with the media, we have problems with social media and disinformation, lies spread faster than truth. We have huge challenges to representative democracy. We've already discussed this morning, is it representative? Well, no, it doesn't look like us. So we need to improve that. But also the rise of deliberative methods and the demand for people that people now have to be more involved in what's going on, affecting their lives. So the Scottish Parliament needs to take all of that on board and change how it looks. The digital society is real. We are a digital society by and large. So Parliament needs to look like that. You need to be a reflection, a microcosm of the society around us, a microcosm of modern Scotland. And I think for me, if I want to describe the Scottish Parliament, I'm very proud to have the Scottish Parliament represent me, because when I go out around the world talking to other parliaments, you are a great example in lots of ways. You're doing really good things and you're dynamic. And I think you're open, accessible and robust in a way that a lot of parliaments are. But the older you get, the slower you get. So don't lose sight of that. We were here for, we were set up for a reason. And one of the things that we were set up to do was to be new and innovative and be part of a new nation. Now, this is a new voice. And I think you have to own that. And you have to use that as the clarion call for innovation and being brave. I think Parliament can be brave, but it has to jettison some of the old culture and the old ways to do it.
Thank you, Dr. Williamson. And can I thank both our witnesses in this second panel session for a very, very informative session. And I hope you continue to follow our inquiry with interest. And we will no doubt bombard you with questions in due course on various matters. But can take this opportunity on behalf of myself and the committee once again to thank you, Professor Childs, for your attendance, and Dr. Williamson, who, with technology allowing at the end, the sheep and lambs being in the right place, we managed to see you very clearly at the end. Thank you very much indeed. I will now move this meeting into private.